Expect the best used car deals guaranteed. Visit arnoldclark.com.
Welcome to Peter and Roughie's Football Show, sponsored by Arnold Clark. I'm Peter Martin, Alan Rough, Tam McManus and Charlie Adam here with us on the programme. Don't forget, if you're on Facebook, to share the stream. Follow us if you can. Join the football family. You can subscribe on our YouTube channel as well and give us your thoughts. Lots to talk about on the day's programme. No surprise, last night it emerged that Neil Lennon, over a 24-hour period, would no longer be the Celtic manager. And that's how it all unfolded. Roughie, are you the least bit surprised?
No, I don't think we're surprised at all. I think after the result of the weekend, I think we were all, well, I was certainly under the illusion that if he continued to win games, the more kind of run that he went on, he maybe sat it out for a wee while longer. But I think we all knew one bad result round the corner would bring everything to a head. And I think the Ross County one did. Obviously, the board have said, look, we can't wait any longer. We've got to really do something about this. So, no, I think it was expected. And he'll just have to deal with everything that goes with it now.
Our reporter Gabriel Antoniazzi was out at Celtic Park today.
Yes, Peter, Neil Lennon has resigned as Celtic manager after 2 years in charge, with the club 18 points behind league leaders Rangers with just 8 games left to play. His assistant John Kennedy has been placed in interim charge. The decision was made this morning. A statement was put out. Lennon himself said that he was frustrated with the difficult season for many different reasons, that ultimately he couldn't turn it around no matter how hard he tried. He always gave his utmost and he will always remain a Celtic fan. Outgoing chief executive Peter Lowell cited his trophy haul. The quadruple treble was won at the end of 2020, of course. He said no one can diminish Lennon's legacy at the club, that he is disappointed, as is everyone. It's understood the Hoops have been in crisis talk since the weekend's loss to Ross County, but the decision has been made now. Questions remain, though. Was it Lennon's decision or was it the board? If it was the board's decision, why now? Could it have been earlier? That's the question all Celtic fans are asking. Could it have come after the League Cup elimination at the hands of Ross County as well at the end of November? Or perhaps after the Old Firm on the 2nd of January, before the fated Dubai trip? Would that have saved the 10th title in a row that all fans here want to see? That's the question everyone will be asking. Looking forward, though, Kennedy is in charge. He's favourite to get the permanent job, though no one really expects him to be the boss come August next season. Steve Clark is next in line, according to the bookies. The current Scotland manager will take his nation to Euro 2020 in the summer. His contract is until the Qatar 2022 World Cup. Could he be tempted back to Scottish domestic football? He was so successful with Kilmarnock. Other names linked: Eddie Howe, Rafa Benitez, Frank Lampard, as well as Belgian boss Roberto Martinez. But it's going to be a huge job for whoever does come in, as well as for incoming chief executive Dominic Mackay. He needs a new manager. Perhaps he'll need a squad overhaul. Ryan Christie, Odson Edouard, Christopher Ayer all have their contracts running out next summer. They will need to be sold if they don't sign a new contract and the club want to make a profit on them. A new manager, a new squad, a director of football. Will that happen? We'll have to wait and see. But the question for Celtic fans is, it was too little, too late. Should it have been done sooner?
Yeah, lots of questions asked by Celtic fans over the last couple of months, of course. If it had been done sooner, Tam, you're of the opinion that maybe they would still be chasing Rangers in the league.
Yeah, I think they'd be closer, certainly be closer, Peter. I don't think there's any doubt about it. I think there's been so much complacency at Celtic for a number of years. I think it started with a League Cup final. I think Celtic got very, very lucky that day, and you know, they won the League Cup final. But I think that should have been a huge warning sign to the board, to the players, to everybody, the fans, that Rangers were improving. They've been improving fast. And I think since then, you know, it's, listen, I think the Rangers have improved year on year since then, and at Celtic have not, and complacency set in. And Sir Alex Ferguson said complacency is a disease, and he never let that sit in at Man United. Year after year, he changed big players, and Celtic have not done that. And I just feel as if complacency has run right through the club. The supporters thought 10 in a row was in the bag. Absolutely no doubt about it. Steven Gerrard had never won a title. He would bottle it. Rangers would bottle it. This was all the stuff I read for months and months, and that's the sort of complacency that's now seeped in, and you're seeing the fruits of that now with Rangers miles clear.
Yep, we'll try and read out some of your messages on Facebook. I'm not sure if we've got a technical hitch on the Facebook or not, but I'll check that out for you. And of course, you can subscribe on our YouTube channel as well as on Twitter. Over and above that, of course, Neil Lennon offered his resignation. This is what he had to say on that statement. We have experienced a difficult season due to so many factors. And of course, it's very frustrating and disappointing that we've not been able to hit the same heights as we did previously. I worked hard as ever to try and turn things around, but unfortunately, we've not managed to get the kind of run going that we've needed. I've always given my best to the club, and I've been proud to deliver silverware to the Celtic supporters. The club will always be a part of me. I will always be a Celtic supporter myself. I would like to thank so many people at the club who've given me so much, and thank my family and of course friends for their love and support. And he wishes Celtic all the best. So the Neil Lennon era is over. Looking back over the carnage, Charlie, the buck stops with the manager, but he has to. There are other people there at fault. The buck stops with the manager, but there are other people who I think have to carry the can as well. Roughie.
Sorry. I think we've already spoke about, you know, he said things haven't went particularly well this year. He'll have to blame himself for a few of these things. But for me, it's the basics. You know, it's not getting the goalkeeper that they really wanted and should have went for and pushed the boat out. Big, big player, whatever. If you've got a first-team goalkeeper who is outstanding, it's a start. It was a back four that was never a back four. I don't think anybody knew who the back four was going to be week in, week out. That's a really bad, sore one if you're in a football team and you don't know who the centre-halves are going to be, who the full-backs are going to be. The midfield is okay, but for me, there was no width in the team. There was not the same kind of width that Celtic usually have. And I have to say, the two strikers, I know Edward is hitting the ball in the back of the net just now, but the two strikers need to hold their hand up and say they've been absolutely diabolical. And I don't know what the reason for that is. Obviously, Edward was looking for a move. Griffiths wasn't supposedly 100% fit. They've got to sit and look at themselves as well. It's just a sort of a catalogue right through it. Okay, we all keep talking about the Dubai thing. But in the light of the Dubai thing, they had 13 players self-isolating for like two or three games. The two players that came back for Scotland duty that were self-isolating, the whole thing was an absolute shambles, you know, and all these things just mount up, and obviously not getting the results. So all in all, the whole thing has been a complete and utter mess, you know, from that day.
I'm sure we could catalogue more than a few games that eventually sunk Neil Lennon. Charlie Ferencváros, a couple of defeats to Rangers, always painful for Celtic fans. Sparta Prague at home, double to Ross County, as well as, you know, draws against Livingston and defeat to St Mirren. Too many draws, in fact, scuppered Neil Lennon being able to take it to the end of the season and even being able to try and hang on the coattails of a Rangers side, Charlie. Let's be totally blunt about this, of a Rangers side that was consistent, had a good recruitment plan and just had gradual progression year on year towards their ultimate goal.
Peter, I don't think whoever was in charge of Celtic would have caught Rangers the form that they've been in all season. They've been incredible. You know, they've lost one game with the, you know, to St Mirren. The record is incredible in home and away in Europe as well. So I don't think that is. I just think that sometimes you just got to look in house and see what the problem is. The players have been a massive problem. You know, we've seen it at the start of the season. Players want away and, you know, don't want to be there when from the outside, you know this is the biggest season in Celtic's history. So you're hoping that everybody inside Celtic is all going in the same way. There was too many wanting to go and leave and do other things. Is that down to the way the manager was working or the style that they weren't happy with? And it's just imploded into a mess. And sadly for Neil, he obviously has to carry the can because he's the manager of the football club. And now he's been relieved of his duties. I think it's, you know, it's... On a personal side for him, it'll be good to get out of the goldfish bowl of this the Glasgow a little bit and be able to see where he goes next. But it's a shame. It's a shame to see somebody like that lose a job. But the players have underperformed and the hierarchy as well. they've underperformed in recruitment and other decisions that they've made.
Yeah, listen, the other aspect of this is, of course, some people say he's resigned. He's been sacked, and his payment terms will be there. His confidentiality clause will be there. I don't think we can hide away from that fact. This is what Peter Lowell had to say in the statement that he released on the situation. I'd like to pay tribute to Neil for all he's done for the club in his second spell, delivering our 8th and 9th successive league titles, the quadruple treble and the last 5 domestic trophies. I've watched Neil fight many battles over the years on and off the field with courage and tenacity few could match. This season he's fought hard and worked tirelessly to turn things around. While this season has not progressed as we would have liked, it cannot diminish the character or integrity of a man who has given the club so much. And he goes on to say, personally, it's a sad day for me to see Neil leave the club. Neil is a man of quality and decency. He will always be part of the fabric of Celtic and will always be welcomed at Celtic Park. I don't think anybody will have any argument with that at all. If at all, you know, when you're looking at the collective blame on this, Tam, you know, I can look over it and I'd say, I think Peter Lowell, I think there was a breakdown that started at Brendan Rodgers. I think the player recruitment strategy was severely in question. I think his timing and his selling policy, you know, didn't do the manager any favours. And I think Nick Hammond's recruitment also needs to come under the microscope. So there's a collective of things there, as well as the fact that, listen, you can't get away from the fact that Neil at times in that season, you know, was playing a 3, playing a 4. Players were played out of position. And if you look on the Celtic squad list, Tam, and I'm not exaggerating here, I have omitted maybe another 7 or 8 players that are you know, are not that they're not worth mentioning, but they're not critical to it. But I'd written the list down, Tam. Mm-hmm. Barkas, fail. Julian injured, should have had a replacement. Greg Taylor and Diego Laxalt, chopped and changed all the way through the season. Shane Duffy, fail. Ayer, shunted from centre to right back, played in a 3, then played in a 4. Never got a settled look at that. El Hamid was homesick. Ralston, deemed not good enough. Welsh, inexperienced, but in the end, their only option. Beaton, a midfielder, played at centre half and get caught out in the Rangers game. Scott Brown, I don't have any qualm with him. I think he was growing old. He's done his part. It's not his fault in my book. Sorrow, dropped to the bench. Turnbull, eventually given a regular position. Christie, in my mind, I think he wants away. Tom Rogic, can't play for 90 minutes. James Forrest was injured, which was critical. Griffiths, out, injured, overweight, and for 7 months, a man down. Ayeti, not good enough. Klamala, not good enough. Edouard, out at the start of the season, a man down, and then eventually came back and started scoring goals. Have I missed anybody?
No, I think you've hit the nail on the head, Peter. I don't think any Celtic supporter would argue with the points you've just made there. You know, and Nick Hammond, listen, I think he's got to come under really, really close scrutiny for me. You know, I know for a fact that the players at Celtic and Neil Lennon wanted to bring Stephen Fletcher in. I know that. I know for a fact they wanted to bring him in. But Nick Hammond messed him and his agent about so much that eventually they walked away. But Stephen Fletcher was desperate to sign for Celtic. Now, in the whole grand scheme of things, that doesn't affect a lot. You know, Rangers would have still won the league and Celtic would have been miles behind. But that's the kind of breakdown, I think, has been between Nick Hammond, Neil Lennon and the board. You know, Neil Lennon wanted Stephen Fletcher and he never got him. So that's, I don't know, that could be happening to other players. But Nick Hammond, you know, to bring Barkas in, as you said, he's been hopeless. You know, Klamala, no good enough, 3 million, a jetty, another 4 or 5 million on him. You know, they've wasted so much money in recruitment. And that's been the massive difference, I think, between Rangers and Celtic this season. The guys Rangers have been brought in straight in to do a job into the first team, and the guys Celtic have brought in have not been good enough. And that's contributed to, what, 18-point lead? And a 31-point swing, is it, Peter, from in a year?
Yeah.
Celtic and Rangers? Incredible.
Peter, it goes back further for me. It goes back well past Brendan Rodgers. You know, if you look at how Celtic have recruited for years and the players that they brought in, it goes back further and deeper than that. And, you know, at times it will catch up. I mean, it's caught up on them. At the most crucial part of this 9 in a row, at the biggest hurdle they've failed. And, you know, it's people have to look at themselves. And, you know, obviously Peter Lowell's going to step away in the summer. And Dominic McKay, or whatever his name is, coming in, he's got a big, big job. Because if he doesn't get this manager right, then all of a sudden, you know, Celtic could be two or three managers in, and Rangers could be two or three titles ahead as well. So this is a big, big appointment for Celtic.
We're going to talk about who the next manager will be in a minute. I'm just going to pick up on your point there, because quite simply, to offer some kind of note of balance on this, one, I don't believe he'll step completely away, Roughie, from Celtic. I think Peter Lawwell, whether it be non-executive director or something, I still think he'll be in the background. I still think he's going to roll somewhere else in football. I do not see him retiring at 61. The view on Peter Lawwell as a chief executive from a business point of view of that board is totally different from how the fans may view how he's handled anything from Dubai to signings to, you know, the way his strategy over the 9 years has progressed and in some cases infuriated. But I think the board will look at it and say he's been a chief executive of massive success with lots of money in the bank account. And that's the way the people who count the money, the accountants, you know, the bank managers, all of them, they will look at Peter Lawwell as a huge success. And I think his power and where he has Celtic on standing, whether it be domestically and the control he has there and in the European front, it is something that I think the board will look upon his time totally differently from some fans who might not look at it favourably. But I don't think for a minute that he's leaving it anytime soon. I think he may well step back from chief executive, but I still think he'll have an input at Celtic. That's just my hunch.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's certainly been there long enough, more than anybody, you know, and you've touched on the money that he's brought into the club and the success there's been at the club. What is it, 22 trophies in 10 years? You know, unbelievable. You know, the fact, you know, that's there, plus the money, plus the good fortune of bringing young players in and selling them on for lots of money. So financially, they're in the right good place, you know. And okay, this has been a horrendous year for everybody concerned at Celtic. I would like to think that a lot of them would remember the previous 9 years, you know, and the success, the Champions League, the group stages, and the playing the Barcelonas, Juventus and everything. And that you don't just get there by a bit of luck. You know, you've got to financially look what you're doing with the purse strings. And I just thought that the decision to be a selling club, you know, and to bring in young players and then sell them on is always sometimes a risky business. It's okay if you get a Tierney or a young player and you can sell them on lots and make lots and lots of money. But when you're not buying real, real quality, and I know when you buy real quality, sometimes that doesn't work either. Tam's already given us some examples of that. But that's the way football is. I mean, how many clubs down in England have you seen spending 20, 30 million in something and they don't even kick a ball? So it was the right route to go down. Unfortunately, it just hasn't worked, because I think the only good signing so far has been Turnbull. So that has to be seriously looked at as well.
Peter.
Yeah?
I'm going to give kudos to Charlie in terms of Adjetti. Charlie Adam and Adjetti signed for Celtic. Charlie took a lot of stick on this programme for saying he wasn't good enough, and he's been bang on. I looked at his record. He made six substitute appearances for West Ham. He had a decent record at Bau over in Switzerland. Six sub appearances for West Ham, and Celtic paid what, 5 or 6 million for him. And they could have got the boy Tony, who's absolutely ripping it up at Brentford at the minute, for an extra 500 grand or whatever it was. Who was proven, he was scoring goals at Peterborough. You know, I just don't understand that one.
Yeah, I mean, picking up on your point, I don't think it's about individuals now. I think the collective is where the whole thing has fallen down. Picking up on your point, Charlie, and obviously Roughie agrees to a certain extent, the strategy of selling players on now, I think we've got to kind of, you know, have a think about this. This is Scottish football. The strategy of buying players, young players, and trying to sell them on for a profit, it's a gamble. It's a gamble at £1 and £2 million. It's a gamble at even 4 and 5. It may well be huge to a Scottish club, but to English clubs, it's a drop in the ocean. But over that period, I mean, unless people have forgotten history, Charlie, you know, when Martin O'Neill left Celtic, there were players that were on huge, huge contracts that Celtic couldn't sustain paying 50, 60, 70 grand a week for players. Bobo Baldi managed to take a full year's money, never kicked a ball for Celtic. So they had to change. And when Gordon Strachan came in, they cut the budget dramatically. And again, when it got to Ronnie Dyla, it was a drop again in quality. The manager was a drop in quality, and the team that he put out in the park was a drop in quality. And it's only when Dermot Desmond put his hand in his pocket and then stopped the rot and got Brendan Rodgers at a crucial period where the quality increased while still trying to maintain that strategy. But my point on this, Charlie, is, you know, in the end, they made too many bad decisions in a collective area. Whether they were arrogant and they thought Rangers weren't going to really challenge them, that's for other people to decide. But they made too many mistakes in one collective season. But they've had nine seasons where Rangers, whether they were weakened, whether they were out of the league, is not Celtic's fault. They had nine seasons of success. I think we have to kind of get a balance here on, you know, it's a bad season, he's blown it, and they will always remember the people who failed as the team who blew the 10. And I'm not just talking about the manager and players. It's the team, collectively, at Celtic who blew the 10 that is annoying people the most.
Yeah, obviously it's a group, it's a collective group, and you know, individuals in that will obviously take responsibility. But if we keep going back to what Celtic had to beat in that 9 years or that period Rangers were gone, Aberdeen and Motherwell, who were probably about 150th in Europe and 180-odd in Europe, coefficient rating. So if Celtic couldn't beat they two to win the championship, then there was something wrong. So that was easy. That's why Ronnie Dial ended up winning two titles. Then they upped it with Brendan and they brought in a little bit of quality. But Brendan's signings weren't as good as what they should be. There was a lot of problems there with Brendan's, but because they had the notion of Rangers and they were still just trying to, Rangers were trying to rebuild. And when the pressure came on, it failed. And, you know, there has to be I look at it from Dermot Desmond to Peter Lawwell to say, right, okay, what did we do wrong? Because the new man coming in has a like I keep saying, has a big, big job to make a decision on what he wants to do next season with who's going to be manager. I don't believe John Kennedy will be the manager. He will get an opportunity from now to the end of the season. If he wins every game, he might get the job, but Celtic need to look at deeper than that, and somebody like Roberto Martinez might step in, who has Sean Maloney as assistant manager, who knows the football club. So somebody like that might be the answer, but we'll wait and see.
Here's the stats on Neil Lennon's two terms in charge at Celtic. And you can see he's not too dissimilar in both cases of, you know, his period in charge. In fact, with a bit of luck, we might be able to see that. Maybe we won't. It's a video. Have a look.
Neil Lennon has resigned as Celtic manager after 2 years, with the club 18 points behind league leaders Rangers in a title race. A legend as a player, Lennon first led the team in 2010, winning three league titles and two Scottish Cups. When Brendan Rodgers left for Leicester in February 2019, Lennon seemed the obvious choice and a safe pair of hands to see out an eighth straight title. In his 14 games in interim charge, he did just that and secured a treble-treble, beating Hearts 2-1 in the Scottish Cup final. He was offered the job on a permanent basis straight after. Last season started brightly, the Hoops continuing their domestic dominance with a hard-fought, if not lucky, League Cup victory over Rangers. And when the pandemic halted the league in March last year, they were awarded the title on a points-per-game basis. However, when football resumed in August, things were different. Summer signings Vasilis Barkas, Albion Ajeti and Shane Duffy all failed to hit the ground running, whilst big stars allegedly tried to force moves that did not materialise. All the while, Rangers rolled on like a steam train. The only thing that was the same was their exit from the Champions League at the hands of Ferencváros. They're out with a whimper, just like the year before against Cluj. The Hoops stayed in touch until the first Old Firm of the season, where a comfortable 2-0 win for Stephen Gerrard's men signalled a run of just 2 wins in 12. Celtic faded away in the league and were embarrassingly eliminated in the Europa League thanks to back-to-back 4-1 losses to Sparta Prague. But perhaps worst of all, they were knocked out of the League Cup 2-0 at home to Ross County, their first domestic cup defeat in 36 games. The cracks had started to show.
I just can't keep coming up with these explanations or excuses because it doesn't match with the Celtic public. I know that. I know things aren't good enough at the minute. And I'm not going to sit here like a happy clapper going, yeah, everything's positive, we'll turn things around. We have to work hard and make it happen.
It seemed the final straw for Lennon, with several banners and eventually several protests, meaning police escorts were needed for players and staff to leave the stadium. However, a show of faith from Chairman Peter Law gave the Northern Irishman a chance to turn things around until the new year. It put down the protests and cued a winning run, including last season's Scottish Cup final against Hearts to seal a quadruple treble, meaning the club headed into 2021, appearingly rejuvenated.
We've won 9 league titles in a row and 4 consecutive trebles, which no other club's ever done, so I don't understand why we're having a difficult season, you know, there's this sort of hysteria to change the board, change the club from top to bottom.
However, they lost the crucial Old Firm on January the 2nd, making it three losses to their rivals in a row. As they flew off to Dubai, so did their hopes of 10 in a row, although Lennon felt the media's portrayal of the trip was out of order.
We weren't hiding anything, we weren't up to anything. We were out there sitting there on our day off, having travelled all through the night, which again is our problem, not anybody else's. But it was impossible to do any training the next day, so they were given some downtime like we all were. And this has been a stick to beat us with, these photographs, and it's completely preposterous.
Two positive tests and 13 first-team players in isolation upon their return led to three draws on the trot, at home to Hibs and then twice to Livingston. It made it just 7 wins in 22 matches for Lennon and rendered Celtic's season all but over, with further damaging losses to St Mirren and Ross County signalling the end of his reign. After 110 games, 77 wins and 16 losses, Neil Lennon's second spell as Celtic manager is over. Questions remain over why he merited this much time in the job, whilst the board will now wait for the arrival of new CEO Dominic Mackay to look for a permanent replacement.
Well, with that in mind, who's going to get the job? This is just my opinion, Roughie. I think Dermot Desmond already has the man. I think he already has done the deal with him. Whether there's a delay, whether it be the Euros or whether it be getting to the end of the season and then starting afresh with players that he wants and the clear out that undoubtedly is going to happen, I think that deal is done. I think he knows the man he wants. I think the man himself will have a deal in place and know how much budget he's got for next season. That's my own personal opinion on it.
I can't believe you're not telling us who it is.
To be perfectly honest with you, Ruffy, the one thing about this programme is, if you get a chance to speak to people and if you get a chance to understand the way they go about their business, Dermot Desmond is not too far away from the way David Murray used to do it with Rangers. He'll look at a situation, you know, whether he did it rightly or wrongly, David Murray, for some Rangers fans, they'll look at a situation, go and say, right, that's the move. This is when I'm going to do it. This is the person I want. Here's the deal. Here's your package. Here's your bonus. And here's what you're going to have to spend to build the club. And this is what your remit is. Win the league next season. And I believe, because of the way he operates, that he will not take it lying down. He doesn't like to lose. And I think he's already got the man that he wants.
Well, whoever is that man is, you know, I'm sure the Celtic supporters will be hoping he's got a war chest, you know, that he can go out there and get the players he wants at the right price and obviously buy the right players for it. Because, I mean, you spoke about it earlier, about all the players that are there this year. And we're talking about what players are going to leave. I think it'd be harder to do a list of who you would want to keep, you know. So I think there's whoever it is going to have to shift a few players. I don't think it'd be hard with some of them, but it's a complete and utter overhaul for me. You know, and I don't know where the players are coming for. They might have to rip up the theory that they've got at this moment in time, you know, to get ahead of Rangers again. They might have to push the boat out to get certain players. But for me, it's all about the recruitment, and we've already discussed it. It's been diabolical this time. So whoever it is, we'll have to come in. We'll have to have the right contacts, obviously. And that is the big thing, you know. It's who you get and what market he's in or what market he's been in, who his contacts are, you know, what kind of player does he identify as the right player. So it's a big, big move, whoever it is, and we'll have to wait and see who that is.
Here are the bookies' odds on it all, Charlie. These are, you know, it could swing one way or the other. You know, bookies just like somebody to put some money on and lose it. John Kennedy, one of the early favourites, which I'm not, no harm to John. I don't think Celtic can put a novice in charge of the club. Steve Clark, Roberto Martinez, Rafa Benitez, I've been told, will get the Newcastle job once the ownership changes. Eddie Howe, Frank Lampard. Are there names, Charlie, that you potentially think will be in that mix?
No, I think, as I mentioned, Roberto Martinez and I think Steve Clark. I think they're the two front runners for me. I just think it'll come to, obviously, like you said, I think Dermot will have the deal done. He'll be, you know, proper businessman. He'll have it wrapped up, ready to go, and he won't want to make it public. But if, like you say, Both teams are going to the Euros, Belgium and Scotland. So he'll want to try and keep that quiet until that's over with. And then one of them two, I think, could be the ones to step in and take Celtic forward.
Strangely enough, I personally rule out Roberto Martinez on the count, Tam, that if he has a good Euro 2020 with Belgium, he could be the next Real Madrid manager.
Yep. He could walk into a job, Peter. I mentioned Roberto Martinez, 6 or 7 weeks ago. I thought that was a name. And then when you think about it more, that Belgian team has got every chance to win the Euros. And as you said, I don't think he would dive into Celtic just now. I think he'd be keeping his options open. I know if he goes to the Euros and they get the semi-finals or the final or even win it, as you said, there could be all sorts of jobs in England. It could be the Barcelona job, Real Madrid. They could get massive clubs in for him. So I don't think he would commit now, Peter, to Dermot Desmond. A yes or a no. But I think Stevie Clark, for me, is one that I think he's a favourite. I think he's a front runner. And I know he didn't like all the sectarian stuff up here. And he spoke out, rightly so, about all that stuff. But I think he would take it, Peter. I think he would take it after the Euros at Scotland. I think he'd get back into club management. He's still quite a young guy. So I think that Clark's the front runner for me for the Celtic job.
Yeah. One of the former Celtic players now playing at Brisbane Roar is Scott McDonald. When this story broke, I caught up with him in the wee small hours of the morning to get his thoughts on Neil Lennon's exit.
I think no question everyone would agree that it is the right call. Probably hindsight's a wonderful thing. And we can talk about should he have gone earlier. Look, yes, but I think it's important now. There's a lot of water under that bridge, and there was measures needed to be taken earlier in the season, and it just hasn't happened. COVID's really affected Celtic Football Club more than Rangers has. Rangers have been steady Eddie and built and being very consistent. It seems like there's a lot of upset within the playing side of the staff at Celtic Football Club, and a lot of unrest in terms of players wanting to leave.
Yeah, that's another thing that I think has been a real thorn in everybody's side from what Scott McDonald was saying there, Roughie. In the background, there's been a fair few players who've caused a bit of carnage.
No, well, obviously, I don't know what month it was. You probably remind me when Neil Lennon did the press conference and said there's certain players don't want to be here. I mean, that is a right eye-opener, that obviously we don't know who they are. He knows who they are. The players themselves know who they are. And how many was it? Was it three? Was it four? Was it five? Was it agents trying to get them out the door? And you have to deal with that. But you can certainly see that he was really, really annoyed by it in that press conference. And he's the one that's got to deal with it. So, I mean, there's like a catalogue of things. That was just the sort of the start of it all. Him coming out and saying, look, there's players don't want to be here. And if they don't want to be at Celtic Football Club, do they think they're good enough to go somewhere else? That's another point.
Yeah.
I think I think the mistake was appointing Neil Lennon in the first place. I think they've done it. Was it after the cup final? In the shower or whatever it was after the game, they announced that Neil Lennon was going to be the manager. Peter, I just don't think he was the right calibre of manager and right calibre to take over from Brendan Rodgers. I just think, I've no harm to Neil Lennon, but taking over from Brendan Rodgers, who for me could win the Europa League this year and finish in the top three in England, he's a top manager. I think you had to go out and get somebody of that ilk, and I feel as if it was a bit of a cheap appointment, to be honest.
You can argue that point, but who was available, Charlie? Who was available to back up Tam's point?
No, I think Neil was right, deserved the opportunity to go, because he stepped in when Brendan left, jumped ship, and went and took the Leicester job. So I think Neil stepped in and he done what he was told to do, win the league, win the trophy, and he got the job. I just think that as it's gotten on and this season, like you say, when your players and your big players want to leave the football club, that's the problem, because they take their eye off the ball. Don't let them kid you that they've all been, there 100% every week, and your Ayers and Beaton and the players that have come in, no good enough, and that's it. And Neil's been let down by the players. Yeah, he's made decisions himself as a manager that's been right. He'll take some of the blame because he's the manager of the football club. But the players have to look at themselves deep down. Did we do enough for this manager? Did we do enough for ourselves? and I don't think they have. Win six, like you say, 5 or 6, want to leave in one window. It's there's a big issue, and it's caused a problem, and they've obviously lost 10 in a row.
Yeah, and the calibre of players you were talking about, Tam, here's a look at the calibre of players under Rodgers and then Lennon.
Brendan Rodgers and Neil Lennon both brought trophies to Celtic Park, but they ended their spells very differently, although both acrimonious in their own way. Let's have a look at the players brought in and how they fared. Rodgers' headline signing in his first summer was Scott Sinclair for £4 million, who was player of the season and scored 62 goals across 3 campaigns. Lennon's most expensive signing was Christopher Julien, £7 million from Toulouse, who despite a few error-prone moments has been largely a success and scored the winner in the 2019 League Cup final. Moussa Dembélé arrived in Glasgow for less than £500,000 and went on to become one of the league's great strikers, scoring 51 times at a rate better than a goal per game before leaving for Lyon for nearly £20 million. The same can be said for wing-back Jeremy Frimpong, who arrived with little fanfare but became a star. He was sold in January to Bayer Leverkusen for £13 million. Christopher Ayo was brought in as an 18-year-old and was developed under Rodgers to become the club's best defender, though Lennon can also claim to have a hand in that. He's played 165 times. Greg Taylor was a defender who Lennon purchased, and although he's not Kieran Tierney, the man he replaced, he has been solid and fought off competition for left-back from Diego Laxalt. Olivier Cham joined in Rodgers' second season but quickly became a key man, winning 9 trophies along the way. He scored the winning goal in Steven Gerrard's first Old Firm and the iconic winner at the Stadio Olimpico against Lazio, but he left for Marseille in January. David Turnbull has been one of the bright sparks in Celtic's dismal campaign. He was purchased for £3 million and he scored 7 times from midfield. He will be central to any rebuild going forward. Olsen Eduard has been the Hoop's main man for years now and was brought in as Moussa Dembélé's replacement for £9 million. He scored 82 times in green and white whilst being named top scorer and player of the year last campaign. Compared to Albion Ejiofor, who was brought in for £5 million, it's night and day. Ejiofor has failed to find his feet despite a strong start and has scored just once since October, struggling to gain Lennon's trust. Lone players were also key, with Patrick Roberts playing a huge role in the Invincible season, scoring 11 times on the unbeaten run. Shane Duffy was Lennon's lone man this campaign, but despite the £2 million fee, he's been a failure. Several high-profile errors have cost Celtic goals and games, ultimately contributing to their trophyless season. However, Rodgers did have his flops, with Marvin Komper, Ebuwe Kouassi and Vakoum Bio all brought in for millions of pounds, with just 21 league games played between them. None are still at the club. Lennon had more unsuccessful signings though, with the likes of Bolly Bulangoli, Vasilis Barkas and Patrick Klamala all failing to rake in the team, despite their £11 million combined fee. In his 3.5 years, Rodgers spent £34 million, 2 more than Lennon did in a year and a half less. Although Lennon can point to more player sales and thus a £6 million difference in net profit, there is no doubting his recruitment was well below Rodgers' standard, despite a similar budget.
Oh, that's interesting, isn't it, Tom?
Yep, well done, Gabby. I like that. Listen, I think you look at the very first guy to come up there, Scott Sinclair. Now, Celtic should, in my opinion, Celtic should never have got rid of him. You know, Neil Lennon, I think, fell out with him or whatever happened. He was out the team, he was even on the bench. I thought he was a great player for Celtic. His goals, he gave them width. I think Celtic have been missing width all season. You know, Scott Sinclair, I feel, should still have been at the club. And I think that was a major, major error from Neil Lennon to let him go. And, you know, you look at that, Sir Marvin Komper. You know, I don't think he played a game for Celtic. He was one that was, I think, was a bit of a laugh, a joke amongst the Celtic supporters. But it just shows you that Rodgers, although he got most of them right, he did have a few duds in there as well. But I think over a piece, you look at that. But Rodgers spent £2 million more, and look at the respective records and the respective trophies between Rodgers and Lennon. I think Rodgers got the most and the best out of the squad that was already there. Forrest playing out his skin, McGregor playing out his skin, Brown out his skin, Edward, you get the most out of all these players, and they've all went back the way I feel under Neil Lennon.
Yeah, look at the Invincibles under Brendan Rodgers. This is the side that he had with Gordon in goal, Lustig, Szymanowicz, Boyata, Tierney, Armstrong, Brown, McGregor, the aforementioned Sinclair and Forrest, with, of course, up front there, Moussa Dembélé. That was the Rodgers Invincible side. This was the last team to take to the field for Neil Lennon, Bain, Kenny, Welsh, Ayer, Taylor, Rogic, Brown, McGregor, Turnbull, and then you've got up front there, Edouard, and I can't quite see that other name there that's just in front of my screen, Christie. So there's your dramatic change, Charlie Adam, in the quality of the team, and of course the balance in that side as well, even with all the injuries.
Yeah, listen, there's a difference in quality from both teams, and it's going to get scrutinised, but, you know, like you say, it's a rebuilding job, and it'll be interesting to see come August how many of the players in that Neil Lennon side will be here again for next season. I don't think there'll be too many. And, you know, Celtic have to get the, I keep saying, have to get this right. And like Ruffy said, I hope there's a war chest. But if you want to try and bring in 8 or 10 players, how much is that going to cost you? And it's going to be a lot of money. So, you know, I don't think Celtic will be going and spending 20 and 30 million pounds on players next summer to try and catch Rangers. There's no way they can do that. So they'll have to be cute in the transfer market and try and get, you know, freeze, or they'll have to try and, you know, get young players in, because, you know, they won't have the money. They won't go and spend 20, 30 million pounds in the summer window.
And as far as this programme is concerned, at the start, way back at the start of the season, we did mention that anybody who's behind in December in this race would be under pressure from the fans to get the sack, whether it was Steven Gerrard or Neil Lennon. It proved to be Neil Lennon, and the Rangers manager takes no great satisfaction in the Celtic manager losing his job.
Well, look, I mean, I can't say I'm surprised, because obviously what's been going on over there. But I obviously take no personal satisfaction from seeing that news to Neil or to any fellow manager that happens to. So I wish him well for the future. Only really found out about it this morning.
Peter?
Yep.
That could have been Steven Gerrard. I firmly believe that. If COVID never came in, and, you know, Rangers were gone for me at that point. Lost to Hamilton Accies at home 1-0, 13 points behind. You know, no chance of winning the league for me, and Gerrard was under serious pressure. So I think he knows the script. He knows the score. It could have been him, Peter, if it wasn't for COVID. I do believe that. And obviously, they've come back stronger than Celtic haven't.
I mean, that's the essence of it, Charlie. When you look at Rangers, the board, they looked at the situation. It's been called the league. They have to get on with it. They stuck by their man. They continued on this plan. He continued with the strategy. You could see, for me, year on year, domestically, better performances, better quality from the players on the park. And the one thing that he's maintained through it all, which I think has kept him in this job and enhanced his stature, Charlie, is the fact that while he was building a side to try and win the league domestically, I thought some of Rangers' performances in Europe were absolutely superb.
Yeah, and that's probably, if you know about the COVID and how they performed in Europe, that's probably why he's probably still there. And, you know, if you look at both teams, you can see which one's well-coached and which one's not. If you see the way the Rangers are playing at the moment, you know, well-organised, they have a way and a structure of playing out from the back and things like that. Celtic don't. And, you know, people say that, you know, Rangers have been brilliant. You know, I think they're, what, one defeat in 41 games, something like that. It's incredible. So the consistency for them has just been phenomenal. And Steven's built his team gradually. The quality from, like you say, it would have been interesting to see what Rangers' team was like against that Brendan Rodgers team to what it was like now, the difference in quality. So that's the difference that they've built each year. And they felt that, the board's felt that they're making good strides, good progress. Yeah, they probably should have won the League Cup final against Celtic, but they never. But they never failed at that. They just kept building, believed in the process, what they were doing. And this is where they are at the moment. 18 points clear, going to wrap the title up in the next couple of weeks, still in Europe. And if they win the next game, they've got a massive chance of automatically qualifying for the Champions League, where there's another massive pot of money that can come in from the TV revenue. So that's only going to make Rangers stronger next season. So then it's a chance. Is it Celtic trying to catch Rangers next season? So there's a different... And now Rangers are in a position where we're strong favourites for the league. Rangers will be strong favourites for the league next year. Now it's about, can Celtic catch them? And Rangers, it'll be a different pressure for them being in front and everybody else trying to looking, trying to catch them.
Well, the key to it all is a title-winning side is a side that you can rhyme off. And Rangers regularly now, you can rhyme off 9 or 10 of the starting 11. And that's the key to it with them. And Steven Gerrard himself reckons that they've made some really good, crucial signings.
I think our recruitment was very good. I think adding key players to what we already had here was very important. I think the experience of the previous two seasons as we've used to our benefit in terms of our growth and trying to move forward. The work that's happened on the training pitch from all my coaching staff that we've put in as well. I think it's been a real combination of factors, but I think the key thing here is always that hunger and determination to become more consistent.
Yeah, and also, Roughie, the Rangers board deserve credit for sticking by him, and whether it was individuals who put their hand in their pocket or fans who contributed, they've spent their money wisely. They've backed the manager and tried to give him as much ammunition as possible.
Yeah, I think they've learnt their lesson from year on year, because when at the start they were bringing up young players for Arsenal and young players for here, and they just weren't hacking it. And year on year, the manager has obviously said, look, I know we've not got an awful lot of money, but you need to find me money. If you want me to take over for Celtic, you need to find me some decent money to get decent players on, not spending a lot of money, but decent wages for them to come in. And I don't think there's been a Rangers failure this year. I can't think of any player that's come into Rangers, whether it's been Aribo or Hadji or Roof or Eton, not one of them has been a failure. And that might be just a wee bit of rub of the green that you get, but you've got to give them credit that they identified the right player to come in to make the team better. And that's what he's did year on year. He's brought in better players. And Celtic have to go back to the drawing board now and get that same sort of a formula, because they're way off track now with some of the players they're bringing in.
Yeah, I hate to say, Roughie, you're just making up names again. Eton.
Who is it this time?
You made a mess of that, Eton.
Oh, I know. Eton sounds like a mixture between Eton and Beton. But, and of course, listen, Roughie, let's not rewrite history. There have been failures, but they've been quickly jettisoned out the door, because Jordan Jones is a failure. George Edmondson's is a failure, but the majority of the players I was talking
about the ones that are actually coming in and performing. Sure, you get rid of the Greg Stewarts and all them, but the main ones that have made the difference have been the ones that have been coming off the bench, you know, and doing the damage.
For me, that's good coaching. That's lads that are not playing, still understanding how to work within the team shape and the structure. You know, that's everybody buying into the same thing. And the biggest thing for him is keeping the ones that have not been playing happy. You know, your Defoe's coming on, you know, making a difference. Eton coming on, making a difference. So that's good man management. Yeah, listen, it's easy when you're winning football matches and that. But what I think about Rangers is that, you know, the lads that are not playing, they're tuned in, ready to come on. And when they do come on, get an opportunity, it doesn't look, you know, it doesn't look like they're missing any of their key players. So that's why they've been so successful this season, that everybody's bought into the way they wanted to move. And they've used the mistakes that they've used in the previous seasons to now be in a situation where they're at. And it's now, can they go and do that consistently well and perform well and win titles year after year?
Yeah, for me, the key to it all, as far as cranking it up, two elements to it: the shambles that was Celtic and the consistency that Steven Gerrard showed at the start of this season, Tam. What he did was he changed what I thought was a real imbalance in the Rangers side, which was too reliant on an erratic striker who scored all the goals. The minute he shifted that side to a strong midfield that played the way that he wanted them to play, the back four suddenly were solid and everybody was working together. And whether Morelos had a meltdown or not, and he was out of the side, it didn't matter, because the other players were in there, were scoring goals and contributing. And I put that down to his greatest success. They were no longer reliant on one player. They were a team, and you could see it every week. Aribo coming in looks good as well. Davis, a full pre-season, able to sit in that midfield and show all his experience. Ryan Jack, a vastly improved player over the last couple of years. So many elements of it all clicked into place. And I think now we're on the verge of watching them dismantle Royal Antwerp, Tam, and go into the last 16 of the Europa League.
No, listen, I think the job that Steven Gerrard's done has been unbelievable. I think he's built from the back this season. I think he's got his back four. And that back four's been there all season, and Alan McGregor. You know, he's no messed about with that too much. You know, he's rotated the midfielders. You know, he's got plenty of options in there. Arfield, Jack, Davis, you know, Aribo can come in. You know, and up front, as you said, he's brought players in that can come in and compete for a starting place. You know, Kamar Roof, you know, was a big money signing, I think, from Anderlecht, from Leeds. You know, big money, Rangers brought him in. He wouldn't have been cheap. Cedric Itten as well, he's come in, international player. So they've brought players in to compete with Morelos. And as you said, they've not been as reliant on him this season, you know, as they have been in past seasons. So I think Charlie made a good point as well about coaching. I think they're so well coached, off the ball and on the ball. Every single player knows what their job is. And that's been a big difference, I think, between Rangers and Celtic. Celtic come in, they're just, for me, they look as if they're playing off the cuff. Players are just running about, you know, and they don't know what they're doing off the ball, on the ball. Rangers are disciplined when they've not got the ball. And when they've got the ball, they're expansive. So they're great to watch in both aspects of the defensive and attacking. And that's why they're one of the best teams in Europe, in the Europa League this season for me.
One thing I would disagree with you on, Charlie, in one element, and then agree with you wholeheartedly, is the point you made that Rangers are the team to chase because they will win the league, I think is 100% correct. I think you're absolutely right. Rangers are the benchmark now that Celtic have to go and chase. But as far as a gap is concerned, I mean, I mentioned at the start of this programme that I think Dermot Desmond has a man already in his mind, done and dusted, deal agreed, everything on the table. The one thing that Scottish football teaches you is it can swing one way then the other. I think he will have players that they'll take money in on. They've still got profit in the bank, and I do believe they will spend to try and wrestle this league away from Rangers, Roughie. I do think they will have money to change this. They will not sit back and accept their lot. I think Charlie's right. Rangers are the benchmark, but I think Celtic with Dermot Desmond will come back with all guns firing.
Yeah, but I think that's where the Celtic supporters' worry will be, that they don't do that. They don't identify that that's what they've got to do. They've got to take a look at the Rangers board and say, look, this is what we need to do to get ourselves in front. And I'm sure the Celtic supporters, Tam's mentioned it earlier, you know, there was evidence that they're not prepared to do that sometimes. I think now they've got to learn the lesson and show the Celtic support that they are prepared. I don't mean shell out a lot of money. There is going to be a lot of money there because there's going to be 10 players going out the door, the likes of Sham and could be Ayer going out the door as well. That's a lot of money you're going to be sitting there with. But you've got to identify the right player. And that's why I worry about who the manager is coming in, you know, how high a profile he is. I think the higher the profile you are, the better chance you've got of players coming to play for you. And I know that's not a guaranteed success either, but I think if you drop your level to somebody who hasn't got the same contacts, then I think you can suffer.
Yeah, okay. Listen, it's a big story. It's well worthy of us giving it as much time as we possibly can. Tam and Charlie and Ruffy and myself have offered your opinion on it. Thank you to the countless amount of people who have offered their own opinion on whether Rangers will disappear off into the sunset and start a dynasty. Some people reckon Celtic will bounce back. We can only give you our opinion, our insight into the debacle that has gone, the new era that's about to unfold, at what point that new man is unveiled, only time will tell. And of course, as far as the here and now, Rangers are on the verge of a title, and I get the feeling from our predictions, I think Rangers can win this one and go through comfortably, Charlie, in this Europa League match against Royal Antwerp. I have them to win it by a couple of goals, 2-0.
Yeah, I'm the same, Peter. I was thinking the same. I think they'll win 2-0 and get them into the next round, and it'll be an interesting draw come Friday. I think they might want to take a crack at one of the English clubs, and he'll have a half a chance.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Leicester against Rangers would be absolutely fantastic. Tam, you know, these things have a strange way of working out. But listen, all that Steven Gerrard will care about is getting into that next round.
Yeah, listen, I think it's difficult for Rangers because they've obviously have won the first leg. Do you stick or do you twist at home? You know, you don't need to win the game. So, listen, I think Rangers will get through it. I think it might be a draw. I think it might be a 1-1 draw, but I think Rangers will get through. But you spoke about, Peter, just going back to what you spoke about, we can change quickly. What if Rangers get to the semi-finals of the Europa League and somebody like Spurs or Arsenal sacked their manager in the summer, you know, they could come in for Steven Gerrard, Liverpool. You know,
no chance.
You know, it can all, listen.
No chance. Liverpool won't sack the manager.
I don't think Liverpool, but I think there'll be big clubs down there who are struggling. I think if they get rid of the manager, Steven Gerrard will be on the shortlist. He has to be on the, even big clubs in Europe, his European run. So it can change.
Well, listen, my attitude on it can change is because, quite simply, I listened to many a pundit when I was head of sport at Radio Clyde saying Celtic will take 5 years to close the gap on Rangers with Dick Advocaat. It took them 5 minutes, and I think they were 2-0 up at Celtic Park in the 6-2 game. And equally, Rangers can peg it back over a 9-year period. They've had to wait and bide their time, and suddenly in the last 2 or 3 Old Firm games, Rangers have been by far the better side, and Rangers fans have been waiting an eternity for that as well. It can all flip. It depends on the ambition, the manager, the recruitment, and how quickly it can all gel. Listen, Martin O'Neill got some top-drawer players. He inherited a Champions League winner. He inherited a world-class player in Larsson, and he bought Chris Sutton, and he brought in Neil Lennon eventually in the December, and suddenly it was all changed. So these things can happen. But listen, we're going to be in for a humdinger of a race next season when we eventually know who their manager is. But I think Steven Gerrard, I'm like you, Charlie, I think Steven Gerrard will win the title this year. Be amazed at the adulation and the you know, the people who love what he's done for Rangers. And I think he'll look and think, I'd like another year at this.
Yeah, but listen, what do you think? Do you think Rangers will accumulate, and do you think they'll have a right go at spending a few quid on a top striker next season?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, listen, with this money, I think
sell Morelos.
Morelos will be gone.
Yeah, they'll sell Morelos. But what
Defoe will go, and who would they go and get somebody in from abroad and spend proper money on him?
Well, I don't think they'll go back to the David Murray days, Charlie.
No,
I think
okay.
Rangers will look. I think Rangers will look and say to themselves, "Okay, there's quite a lot of people who've put money into Rangers, Charlie. I think they will get paid back if they can land 20, 30 million from the kitty in the Champions League." I think they'll look and they'll say to themselves, "The money this year that they've raked in, the season ticket stampede for next season. I think they'll go out and buy 2 or 3 quality players, but not at tens and 20 millions. No chance."
No, I'm not thinking. I'm lunacy. Thinking maybe 5 or 6 million. You know,
yeah,
I think they go
absolutely.
Maybe go 6 or 7 million. If you get the Champions League money and they get that big, the TV money and things like that, absolutely, and fans back in the stadium. But would they go and sell Morelos and go and get somebody for maybe 6, 7, 8 million pounds and try and, you know, I don't think Rangers will go and buy 5 or 6 players. I think there'll be 2 or 3 maximum next summer.
Yeah, and I think Morelos will be out the door. But it's going to be interesting. Listen, a few points I want to get you guys your thoughts on. One of them, Roughie, is Neil McCann in as temporary manager at Inverness Cali Thistle. We all have passed on our best wishes to our thoughts and prayers, definitely to Robbo and his family. But Neil McCann is a confident boy. He'll be in there and he'll want to put his ideas and his own imprint on the Inverness Cali Thistle.
Yeah, well, he certainly had a lot of experience. He's got a good CV as a manager initially, and then sometimes it goes a bit pear-shaped. So he's been there or thereabouts. They've identified somebody who'll know what that league's all about and how to get out of it. You know, we know it's just short-term, and hopefully Robbo can come back as quick as possible. But it just shows you, it never leaves you. You know, okay, he's doing the TV and he'll be enjoying that as well, but there's no substitute be actually making the decisions and being part of it day to day. So I'll just give him a wee taste of what he's been missing.
Yeah, Charlie, I think the remit's simple. Just try and get him to the playoffs.
No, it will be. I texted him last night, you know, saying good luck apart from next week. We play them next week. So I've heard good things about him. The lads at Dundee speak quite highly of him and how he coaches and things like that. You know, he knows how to set his team up and has a way of playing. So no, it's good to see him back. I like Neil. I was a young kid at Rangers when I was growing up. But, you know, obviously for Robbo, it's, you know, sad, sad times. And, you know, thoughts and prayers are with him and his family at this tough time. So, you know, hopefully everything's back and he's back in the football because he's a good guy and a very good coach as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Give us your predictions then, Roughie. It's Motherwell against St Mirren tonight. Motherwell with 14 first-team stars not available. I'm going for a 2-1 win for St Mirren, Roughie. What are you going for?
I'm going to go 2-1 Motherwell.
Yes. Charlie?
he's gambling now. He's throwing the dice, Roughie.
I'm in your camp, Peter. I'm going to go 2-0 St Mirren. I think St Mirren will beat them.
Yep, Tam?
I had 2-1 down. I'm loath to go the same as Peter, but I don't want to change it. I'm going to go 2-1 to St Mirren as well.
Tam, we're neck and neck. Let's just ride off into the sunset and wave goodbye to him. He's buying the meal. This is straight.
We're getting closer, aren't we? We're getting closer. What
a night we're going to have.
It'll not be the 21st of June, so you can hang on.
With all due respect, it might be different, but the good news is the staff party, when it eventually happens, Charlie, it'll start at 7:30 in the morning, and by about 7:45, I think we'll all be absolutely bladdered. It's as simple as that. We've waited such a long time for it, Tam. Oh, it's an old dear. Absolutely. Once we get our vaccination passports and we're allowed into Dublin, Charlie, we're all straight there for the whole weekend. It's going to be absolutely sensational.
anyway, no, can't wait. Anything else.
Exactly. Another little thing here, I think it's nice to mention, Marvin Bartley has just talked about the fact that this weekend, we'll hear from Callum Davison tomorrow, but this weekend, Marvin Bartley saying Livingston could win the League Cup. Oof, that would be absolutely fantastic.
Coming into the professional game really late, and then, you know, when I did finally come up to Scotland, you know, people were telling me I'm basically, you know, going to semi-retirement and I've got no ambition. You know, I heard that from a few managers and a few people who, you know, I turned down to come up here. And, you know, I've come up here now, I've won the championship, you know, I've been part of the squad that won the Scottish Cup. You know, hopefully I can, you know, complete that while winning the League Cup on Sunday.
Yeah, it's always nice, Tam, to hear the disdain that managers have for Scottish football down south, isn't it?
Yeah, and Charlie know that himself, didn't he? You know, there's not a lot of respect for the game up here amongst the English players and pundits. So, fair play to Marvin Bartley. As you say, he's part of a good Hibs team under Neil Lennon and Alan Stubbs. And they could win the League Cup again for the first time since 2003 when they beat Hibs in the final, unfortunately. But I fancy St Johnstone, to be honest.
Yeah, so do I. Charlie, who do you fancy?
I'm with St Johnstone as well. But a couple of weeks ago, I would have said Livingston, but they're in a bit of a tough time now, aren't they? So I'm St Johnstone.
Roughie, where's your money?
Yeah, St Johnstone for me as well. I think big players have all came.
Full house.
Is it a wee count? Is this getting counted in the competition before we go any further?
Absolutely.
Is it just league games?
Yeah. No. We'll throw this one in.
Okay.
League Cup final. It's the same thing.
Okay.
Yeah, League Cup final. Lord. Yeah, Charlie, you're not with us on Friday.
Just adding games on.
I'm here Friday. Yeah, we play Saturday. It's later in the month. We play Alloa.
Yeah. Excellent. I'm glad of that. Now, listen, just before we go, guys, what game are you watching tonight? I watched Giroud's overhead kick last night, which was absolutely sensational. I'm looking here. It's Atalanta against Real Madrid or Gladbach Manchester City. I think I'm going to go with Gladbach Man City. Am I in the right zone, Tam?
Oh, some crackers there, but you've missed the game of the night. St Mirren v Motherwell, which I'll be tuning into on Saints TV.
there goes the big satellite dish again. This is unbelievable, Roughie. Yeah. He's just...
amazing.
The satellite on it's Mars? It's just incredible. It's giving him colour pictures of everything, Roughie.
It's funny enough, I bumped into a boy the day who works for the licensing board and he was asking for Tam's address.
Oh, God. Snitches get stitches.
Yeah, that's terrible. Tam, you're an absolute rogue. I love you. Anyway, apart from anything else, thank you to the countless thousands of people posting messages on Neil Lennon. The Neil Lennon era at Celtic is over. He is now no longer the manager. John Kennedy takes charge until the end of the season, assisted by Gavin Strachan. Will he be the new Celtic manager? Will it be someone else? It is a high-profile job. Will it be someone that satisfies the demand of and the expectation of the Celtic fans to try and cut that gap on Rangers and make it a title race next season? Only time will tell. Thank you to each and every one of you for sticking with us here today. Don't forget to follow us. Don't forget to like and share. You can see a longer version of my one-to-one with Scott McDonald there. There's a one-to-one out today with Richard Foster, which is really good, talking about his life with Amy McDonald, the pop star, and of course other things that he hopes for in the future when he eventually hangs up his boots. Well worth a listen on our one-to-one. And don't forget also, we've got a chance for you to win an iPad, an Xbox, and a Diego Maradona canvas, all in one big prize in our competition. Make sure you have a look at that on Facebook and, of course, on our website as well. From everyone here, from Tam, from Ruffy, from Charlie and myself, Peter Martin, thank you for watching.
Expect the best you